transformations. Here, there are a number of them. Tetralogy of fallacy is something very, very important. But right now, what we are talking about is this persistent truncus arteriosus. Remember, in a previous discussion, I showed you that the part beyond the ventricle is called bulbus cordis. That bulbus cordis, I also told you, is divided into two parts, a conus arteriosus and a truncus arteriosus. Now, a bulbar septum is formed so that the aorta and the pulmonary arteries are clearly demarcated. That's good. But if that bulbar septum is not formed or not properly formed, you will have what is called as a persistent truncus arteriosus. I repeat, it will have a persistent truncus arteriosus. Again, interpretation of the pathology using common sense on a scientific process, just to describe, even the truncus arteriosus is not bifurcated, it is natural that the pulmonary artery and the aorta are not demarcated. So there is only a single outflow chamber, and both the that single outflow chamber will have its continuity with the right ventricle as well as the left ventricle. So technically what happens is, although the structure is there, functionally it looks like it is a three-chambered heart. You see, three-chambered heart. What do you mean by three-chamber? There are two, right atrium is there, left atrium is there. But the other one, that is the right and the left ventricles together, are still a single ventricle. That's why I am trying to mention that this part of the development in the vicinity of the bulbous cordis, particularly the lower bulbous cordis, is very critical, because it can cause serious consequences on the neighboring structures. As a result, here is a situation where both the right ventricle and the left ventricle pump blood into the same vessel. Subsequently, you can see it goes, and there is a confusional bifurcation. Some amount goes into the systemic circulation and some amount goes into the pulmonary circulation. Well, circulation is going on, but the point is, the blood that should have been strictly deoxygenated and going into the lung is not really differentiated. That means the same blood, which is an intermediate level of oxygenation, is distributed to the lung as well as to the human body. So you can imagine the consequences. That means poorly oxygenated blood is reaching the systemic circulation. Now, the complications and the consequences are becoming really, mind-boggling. Shall we take a 2-minute pause, and if there are any questions, I would like to address, because the more we go, the more baffling and mind-boggling the pathologies are going to be. And today there is hardly any discussion on the embryology. It's all pathological embryologies. Any doubts, please, up till now?
Sir, are all these defects treated surgically after birth?
To some extent, to a large extent. It depends on the complication, degree of, how bad the pathology is, how bad the functional consequences are. Like that. Don't you think, you look at it positively, don't you think it's a blessing that we are able to treat it, almost all these cases, surgically?
Yes.
See, I'll tell you one thing. Caught early, and given the right kind of surgical intervention, you are creating a miracle in life. Do you agree with this? Otherwise, yes, that child is going to be a living vegetable. Stunted growth, everything, all possible ways, God has created a monster. And you, because of your scientific knowledge, applying it for the right time, at the right time, for the right child, you are converting it's an emotional disaster to the parents also, isn't it? But by this intervention, you are giving that family a new lease of life. Agree?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes. Shall we proceed further?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Now you see, here is another condition, transposition of grape vessels. You see, nature not only creates pathology, like a monkey, it also acts funny. Okay, in your wildest dreams, you won't have imagined a condition like this. Normally, the pulmonary artery must arise from the right ventricle. The aorta must and should rise from the left ventricle. But because of reversal of the formation of the bulbar septum, you see, I told you, that spiral staircase. For some pathology, it may be the other way around. You know, if it turns in one way, you get the right. But if it turns the opposite direction, what was supposed to be, right ventricle pulmonary tract will now reverse. The pulmonary artery will arise from the left ventricle and the aorta will arise from the right ventricle. It is a total disaster, isn't it? It's a total disaster because when the right ventricle pumps, the blood is going into the aorta and that is a deoxygenated blood. How do you expect the child to survive? See, as long as the child is in utero, there is a placental circulation, somehow manageable. The moment it comes out and takes a deep breath and there is a circulatory change at birth, immediately the child will go into a cyanotic state. You understand my point? Fortunately, this is also treatable. They will reconstruct the bulbar septum, at least theoretically, for your level of understanding. That bulbar septum will be reconstructed and continuity restored. Remember, from a surgical point of view, we look at it as a some kind of a automobile engineering or repair. We as treating doctors will consider right ventricle as a pump, left ventricle as a pump. It pumps no matter where the blood goes. It doesn't know where it is going. But if there is a reversal and if you can cross the reversal, the problem gets solved. You see, the problem gets solved. So this is another fascinating case. Fortunately, for all the interest and all the curiosity that these cases generate, they're not very common and they're not the everyday case. Okay, a small percentage of the cases. Now, similarly, the aortic and the pulmonary arteries, I repeat, these big vessels can be stenotic. Stenosis means below the stenosis, there is a buildup of pressure. So in the case of pulmonary stenosis isolated, there will be pulmonary hypertension and its consequences. And in the case of aortic stenosis, similarly along the aortic stream. Next. Now, this is how the stenosis is. This is the healthy valve. Watch my highlighter on the left side. And this is how the same valve looks in the, when it closes, there is a gap. When it opens, there is a gap, but that is still not large enough to allow the flow. You see, when it closes, there is a small slit. It should not be there. It should be fully closed. So neither is it fully open, nor is it fully closed. This condition is a stenotic condition. Next. This is a very popular defect. I repeat, this is a popular defect. Very, very, very common. You may see it in the newspapers and other things. At least from the publicity side, it has caught a lot of attention. But then remember how serious this problem is. Tetralogy of Fallot. It's called Fallot is Fallot, but it's called Fallot. Fallot. Now there are four problems in the same heart, four pathologies in the same heart. The reason is the defect is in the region of the endocardial cushion. I told you, the endocardial cushion is a very dangerous zone. One area is affected automatically, then adjacent areas are also to a greater or lesser extent involved. So this combination of four defects in the same heart is known as tetralogy of Fallot. The reason is it is four defects. All are attributed to the same cause, namely the endocardial cushion defect. These four problems are, you see, the pulmonary artery is narrow, a condition known as pulmonary stenosis. I repeat, subvalvular pulmonary stenosis. Because of this stenosis, normally the right left ventricle should have been large in the normal condition, but because of the stenosis, the right ventricle are hypertrophy. You see the thickness of the right ventricle, the wall is thick. Then there is a classic left to right shunt across the ventricular septal defect. See, already three pathologies. One is pulmonary stenosis, second, right ventricular hypertrophy, third, interventricular septal defect, and four, overriding of the arch of the aorta. Overriding of the arch of the aorta. Because the defect is in the endocardial cushion, one is the pulmonary stenosis is there, arch of the aorta overrides this area. As a result, the blood in the left ventricle as well as the right ventricle will go into these two arteries. You see, an admixture takes place not only through the VSD but also through the overriding of the arch of the aorta. As a result, this is a great threat to the degree of oxygenated blood that reaches the systemic circulation. So what happens immediately after birth, maybe a few days, slowly the symptoms will start showing. The baby will be taking a feed and suddenly it will turn blue. The mother will panic and they will rush to the doctor. Sometimes, you know, not only turn blue, it may even fall unconscious. So then you know that this is something very, very serious, and then the doctor will do the testing and other things. And finally, if there's a defect, they will try their best to rectify the defect. Sometimes, mind you, these defects look theoretically very simple to treat, but it's very complicated when it comes to actual practical surgeries. Okay, I'll tell you the relevance of why these things are very, very difficult and dangerous in due course.